Roll up, roll up. Look at my wares. Ye feast, yeast your eyes, ye mighty mortal. I don't know. I didn't really plan that intro very well. It's so hot in England right now that my nipples are like melting. Like, I feel like they're going to fall off. This is Green White Death and Taxes. I've played this deck a million times, both here and on my channel. I do love playing with these cards in Modern, when Modern isn't going to kick my head in. So I say love with an asterisk, and then at the bottom of the page there's an asterisk when I don't feel like I'm really outgunned by everything in the format. And sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. It generally varies. Although post-Modern Horizons, Modern's been rough, hasn't it? I mean, rough in different ways to what it has been before, but rough nonetheless. This is Green White D&T. Our main new addition today from M21 is Containment Priest. It is now Modern legal, it is now Standard legal, it's now Pioneer legal, it's now Historic legal. That's right, Containment Priest is legal in more formats right now and probably for a very, very long time than the Leonin Arbiter. What a weird world we live in. The reason we're playing Containment Priest in this deck is because it kind of combos, kind of doesn't combo with a few of our cards. So with Containment Priest in play, our opponents cannot put cards into play that were not cast. Creatures, should we say. So that means that they cannot bring back cards with Resurrection and stuff from the graveyard. That's Unearth, Goyo's Vengeance, Narc Amoebas, all that kind of stuff. And Burial Rites if someone's playing that sort of nonsense. It also means you can't cheat cards in off of Aether Vial, so it's kind of good against humans in the mirror and similar stuff. What it also means is that when we flicker whisper out their creatures, they don't come back. They just stay in exile. And same as Eldrazi Displacer. You display something and it goes away forever. So yeah, that's the combo. That's the combo. It's basically Splinter Twin. There's also a non-bow, an anti-synergy, in a sense that once we have Containment Priest in play, our Vial no longer makes creatures, and our Restoration Angels are just 3/4 flash creatures, because if we exile our own creature, it goes away forever. And we can't displace our own things, we can't whisper our own things, which is what you do like 70% of the time. So, yeah, it's hard to determine or decide exactly where it fits, whether it's a main board card. I mean, it's definitely a sideboard card. Right, like Dredge will hate this. Neoform will hate this. You know, the five cards that Goyo's Vengeance hates, you won't believe number four, but you do believe it because just Containment Priest, that sort of thing. Should have been the main deck? I don't know, but that's what today is. It's a chance to give it a shot. Other than that, it's a pretty stock list that I've been playing for quite a while now, but I feel like it's got weaker and weaker, especially against all the snow decks and stuff. I think the black-white version is better if you're going to see a metagame full of cryptic commands, because you can actually tear the hand apart with your Thoughtseizers, your sideboard Thoughtseizers, and of course your zombie on a boat, whatever the hell it's called. But yeah, this is Green White D&T. It's really, really hot. It's too hot for me to do a whole full-on intro where I explain the whole deck, because I've explained the deck a million times. There are many videos on Channel Fireball and my own channel where I talk about this deck, so I'm just going to cut that this time. I'll probably talk through it again in future videos, because I can't just always refer to an old video. That's not fair. But let's get on, play some Modern. Don't forget, this is channelfireball.com, your premier source for all things magic. I'm Vince Austin, as Pleasant Kenobi on the internet. Probably one of the most good-looking of the magic content creators. Giving Brian Kibler a run for his money. Brian Kibler's just kind of like... Do you reckon Brian Kibler's got a waxed chest? What has got a waxed chest? He seems like I have a waxed chest. Brian Kibler's your hairless one. Meanwhile, I'm more of a ape-like in my same proportions. I don't have an ape-like chest or hands, but I do have hair, like, everywhere. I even have back hair. Hope that doesn't give you nightmares. Like, comment, and subscribe. Let's play some Modern. Right, you're going to hear some birds chirping in the background because I have to have a window open because it's incredibly hot in the UK. Like, incredibly hot. Now, it's probably not as hot as some of the people watching this from, I don't know, Phoenix, Arizona. Is that a place? I literally just pulled two words out of my mind hole there. But bear in mind the UK doesn't have aircon. I've got a very small fan in my room that I can't have on my recording, otherwise it'll just make it sound way more awful than it already does. And it's quite humid too. So I'm just damp right now. Like, every part of me feels horrid. And that doesn't not include the whole Goblin Guide swinging at us on turn ones. This is Burn or Prowess. Does Prowess even play Goblin Guide? I can't even remember. It's Revealed a Containment Priest. We have three lands in hand. We have an Aether Vial. So we're going to go turn one Aether Vial, 2/3 drops. The 2/3 drops don't look great against the Red Burn deck, if I'm honest with you. Or any aggro deck, for that matter. The Containment Priest might just play the role of roadblock here to get in the way of the Goblin Guide or eat a burn spell. Would be nice to be able to get into play alongside the Eldrazi Displacer to do what we, well, intend to do. But I don't think this is the deck where that's going to really work. What I would love is for the Goblin Guide to attack, find us another land, and then we find a different 2-drop off the top. Thalia, perhaps, would be good, especially if they haven't got the burn. Sacred Foundry from them suggests that they are conventional burn, I believe. Now, I'm a little bit out of practice with Modern. companions kind of killed my love for playing any form of magic that wasn't commander, essentially. But as far as I understand it, the prowess decks tended to be mono red prowess, with the only red white land being the Horizon Canopy esque Sunbit Canyon. The white in burn allows you to play mainly Boros Charm. They have Suspender Rift Bolt as well, and play the second Goblin Guide. This is going to be a lot of damage, but two Goblin Guide triggers, so hopefully it just pulls us two lands at the top and digs us into another two drop, hopefully. Path to Exile on top of our library. Okay. So, we get a 14. The great thing about Containment Priest having Flash is that we don't have to like play it this turn and have it bolt at the beginning of the turn. I'd love to use the ability, so we'll tick up our thing, my wob. We're going to go Razor Verge Thicket. I guess what I can do here is path one of them, giving them a land, but not having our priest necessarily die. So next time we can go Blade Splicer plus priest. The problem with priest is that it turns off our Aether Vial. So we kind of want priest just to die, honestly. So maybe roadblocking it is the correct way to go. So we're going to go combat and attack. We're going to see trigger, trigger. Lands? Yep, one land. Second land. Oh yeah, that's right. The presents that keep on giving. So, roadblock Containment Priest or Path to Exile and Goblin Guide. I guess we hold the path up for an Eidolon, honestly. So we're going to flash in our Containment Priest. Because they could post combat play an Eidolon here, and then we can't kill it outside of them like, attacking into our open Aether Vial. We're okay with Priest dying here because it turns off our Vial. So trading one for one is fine. We go to 9. We really want to draw some Knights of Autumn and then flicker them. That's probably our best bet. Lava Spike us to 6. Chandra's Incinerator. Oh boy. Okay. Well, we're going to be passing that. No two ways about it. This is the new M21 hotness that Burn has that I forgot existed, and I'm actually looking forward to playing with in decks like this. Not this that I'm playing, but their deck. Okay. Okay, okay. So, we have to path it. Yeah, that's because they can bolt our face and still kill our blocker. Okay. Rage of Verge Thicket number 3. Let's go ahead and pass the turn to them. Two from the Goblin Guide here means we're dead to Boros Charm. We're also dead to any combination of 2-3 damage spells. And although we've had quite the suboptimal draw compared to their relatively standard draw, I'd say, it's not like unlucky for us. It's not unlucky for us that Burn happened to have like a critical mass of Burn spells. That's kind of what Burn just does. So we can't really bemoan that. It's just been a bit of a rough game for us having a lot of 3 drops. Sure. So Goblin Guide reveals Restoration Angel. Okay, let's go ahead and path to exile this. Post-board will have access to 4 Knights of Autumn, which is the closest we've got to Kitchen Finks in the current metagame. Also, Kitchen Finks is non-bows with Containment Priest. Don't forget, it doesn't come back. So Knight of Autumn is now just the best Finks equivalent. Seal of Fire from our opponent. One more mana up here. 2 cards in hand. Lava Spike is down to 1. Yeah, we're dead. We're dead. Okay, that was a bad game 1. To say otherwise would be a lie. Okay. Post-board, we obviously get stronger. We're going to bring in Knight of Autumn. Knight of Autumn, Scavenging Ooze. Both Eidolons of Rhetoric. And a Burrowed Fortune. And maybe the Selfless Spirit. We're going to be cutting... Containment Priest is just not good enough here. Eternal Witness is very, very slow. Wisp is pretty slow. Displacer is very slow too. So I'm probably going to cut 3 Displacers, bring the Wisp back in. That puts us to 60. Do I want Selfless Spirit over anything else in this list? No, I think that's good. I think that's good. So we now have 5 ways to gain life in the main deck, which is 4 Knight of Wands and Scavenging Ooze. We haven't got access to Stoneforge plus Batterskull, which would obviously make the matchup a little bit better. Just a small amount. But I'm not a big fan of playing Arbiter alongside Stoneforge Mystic, honestly. I guess Giver of Runes make the matchup a little bit better as well. I've forgone playing those in this list. If I was on black-white, would I have room for Givers? Maybe. Maybe. I probably want Selfless Spirit over an Eldrazi Displacer, actually, come to think of it. Like, it gives us less chance of resetting our Knight of Autumns. Like, actually only, like, 7 ways of doing it with the Flicker of Wisps and Restoration Angels. Only 7! As opposed to the usual 11. Our opponent's taking a bit longer to sideboard than us. What would they be bringing in? Smash and Smithereens, probably. I'd love to play first. Turn 1, Aether Vial. 3 drop and 2 4 drops. This is slow. This is very, very slow. If we had a Mana Dork, it'd be so much better. I don't think we can keep this. It's too slow. Okay. Double Aether Vial. So we're going to ditch one of those. Put it on the bottom of our library. Done. We're going to go Razor Verge Thicket into Aether Vial, making a Noble Hierarch on that end step. I guess we can do turn 1 Noble Hierarch, play a Thalia on turn 2, but the problem being that if they bolt the bird, we don't get to the Thalia. But this way, we do get to the Thalia, even if we don't draw another land, and they bolt the bird. So this secures the fact that we're going to be able to get Thalia into play and then start playing Wisps as well. Thalia plus Wisp also means that if they stumble on land drops, we can sort of flicker out lands and make their mana awkward too. Monastery Sisper. So we're going to take 1 here, going to 19. We're going to untap and hopefully draw a land. That's what we really want to draw. Another Thalia. Okay. Not terrible, because they'll probably kill the first one and the second one will stick around. Thalia is very good against Goblin Guide, but not as good against Swift Spear. I mean, it makes Swift Spear's like damage output quite a bit lower. But obviously one spell allows them to get through a blocking Thalia. Scalding Tarn for my opponent. They're going to crack it, going to 18. So their mana base is being quite painful, but it doesn't really matter if they're outputting a lot more damage than we are. Eidolon of Rhetoric wouldn't do a whole lot here. Double Burn Spell would. Rift Bolt from our opponent. Lava Spike from our opponent. So Rift Bolt's on Suspend. Rift Bolt will cost them 1 mana next turn because of Thalia. So they're going to get us for 2. Yeah. So we go to 14. On their end step, we're going to make a Noble Hierarch. We're going to untap. We're going to take up our Vial. So lands and spells, all of which is good here. Eidolon of Rhetoric. Cool. So let's go white, green, make a Thalia. They'll Rift Bolt the Thalia, which will cost them a mana, and then we'll just Vial in the other Thalia to really lock down their mana. If they miss a land drop, which Burn can. Burn likes to work on like a critical mass of minimal lands, right? So they're going to pay for this Rift Bolt. It's going to target the Thalia. It's going to grow the Swift Spear, unfortunately. They might target the Hierarch, but I doubt it. So they have to pay 1 mana here because of the Thalia. It's going at our face, interestingly. Okay. I'm fine with that. We can throw Thalia under the bus. They play a second land, another painful land. They go to attack. We're going to go blocking. Sure. Do we want to make a Thalia before their second main in case of like lava spikes and stuff? Nah, I want to make an end step in case of lava spikes and stuff. Well, lava spike can't target it. Maybe I should have done. If they double non-creature spell here, I'll feel silly. Skewer the critics. Okay, that's a sorcery speed spell. So we're going to activate our Aether Vial here. We're going to make a Thalia. We're going to take 3 and get an 8. Oh, they shot the Noble Hierarch. Okay, I'm okay with that. I think, he says. Okay, let's say yes to the Aether Vial uptick. We drew a Scooze, so another land will put us in Scooze, which then can eat our creatures and get us some life, but we can't currently do that. I guess I'm gonna attack? Because we ain't blocking with our Thalia. So take them to 14. We've got two cards in hand. Swift Spear we can flicker out to nullify its damage. We can also flicker up our own Thalia to protect it and then block with us to nullify damage too. If we flicker out our Thalia though, it allows them to cast multiple spells. So they're going to attack with Monitory Swift Spear. I'm going to let one damage through if that's their plan. We go to 10. Okay, nothing from them. So if we make a Thalia here, we're going to feel... Sorry, if we make a creature here and they kill the Thalia, we'll feel a little bit bad. But I'm going to use this ability to make an Eidolon. Okay, so they can only cast once per turn now. Cool. We really want to draw a land. Yeah, buddy. So we can make our Scavenging Ooze. Then we're just going to get in for two. We're turning a corner. It's still pretty touch and go. We're on 10. They have three cards in hand. They can cast it like a bolt in our turn, a spell in their turn, a bolt in our turn. So the Idol of Rhetoric is only like a minor hindrance to burn. It's not like a haymaker like some people might think it is. And I don't believe it is either. Some people are like, is that even that good against burn? Well, it's a 1-4 blocker that does make them have to play on our own terms. So that is something. And then we're just going to keep up Aether Vial. We might protect our Scavenging Ooze with a Flicker Wisp here, simply to allow our Scooze to get us two life next turn and get big. They untap, they didn't cast a single spell on our turn either. No Boros Charm, no Lightning no Lightning Bolt, so maybe they don't really have a whole lot. They attack with a 1-2. We're going to block with our Eidolon of Rhetoric. Now, if they bolt this, for example, we can have to save it with Wisp, but that will allow them to cast another spell. One damage on our Eidolon. So they can now bolt our Eidolon dead, for example. One damage from their lands, of course. Two mana. What's it going to be? What's it going to be? Paying costs. Still, 2 mana, 3 mana. Nope. Just another Swift Spear. Okay. So they've cast a spell for the turn, so we are free. Like, this is literally free here. I should have flicker with my... Oh, that was a mistake. In main phase 2, I should have flicker with my Razor Wisp. I had it come back and eat something this turn. I made a mistake there. So we're going to make a Wisp. And the Wisp is going to take away their Sunbeak Canyons. They only have one mana in our turn, so they can't bolt anything. So we're pretty free to do whatever we want, you know? We can also Ghost Quarter ourselves to get another green source for that push. They can't cast any more spells here because of Eidolon. So they're thinking, but they can't do anything because of Eidolon. Then we untap. We do not take up Vial. So we'll say Always Know now at this point. I just start Always Knowing to it. I burn too much time with Vial. Drew another Wisp, which is pretty good. We're going to go to attacking, and we're going to attack with Thalia, Scavenging Ooze, and Flicker Wisp. Load of damage here. No blocks. So we're going to eat and go Noble Heart with this green mana here. Go to 11. Deal 8 to them, which puts them dead to a Wisp in the air. We're then going to pass the turn. They're going to get a land back here, so they can end step something. But ideally, they want to cast their spell. Well, they can only cast one spell turn, so they should instant summon our turn. Nope, nothing. Arid Mesa from our opponent. They crack it. That's a very quick crack. Have they got some really ridiculous... Maybe their hand is stuck with all these, like, six-drop creature mode things from M21, the Chandra's Fiery Angry Man. Maybe it's that. Because those seem... Actually, I don't know if Rhetoric probably gets a lot better against those Angry Fiery Men, right? I've run out of water, so I'm very thirsty now. So they're going to attack. I am not going to risk any sort of like Boros charm. It'll be 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So I'm going to activate my Aether Vial. Say yes. Make a wisp. I'm going to flicker out a Monastery Swift Spear. Okay, cool. We got there in game 2. We turned a corner by playing a lot of tricksy nonsense. I'm probably still on the same plan as I was before. None of this stuff changes when we're in the draw. It's very, very similar. Let's go, let's go, let's go. What was the best card in that game? I don't know. It's sometimes in games with like this deck and other versions of D&T and Modern and even Legacy, sometimes it's hard to determine what the MVP was because they all like... It's death by a thousand cuts, or they synergize, or like compound together. So obviously Thalia was good there. I don't know, Rhetoric ended up being very good. Our opponent bricking, it seems, with 2 or 3 cards in hand, so I'm assuming they drew either lots of land or lots of those 6 mana angry, fiery things. Chandra's angry, pokey, burny thing. So maybe, yeah, our MVP might have been our opponent drawing badly, or the new hotness for burn not being good enough. Maybe that's the MVP here. This hand is pretty gas. Turn 1 Vial, we've got Burden Forge Tender, Knife 1. I mean, we're a little bit soft to our Vial getting blown up by a Smash to Smithereens and us not drawing a third land, but I think we can risk it. Seal of Fire from our opponent. Burden Forge Tender allows us to get around that killing something beautiful. We're going to untap and hope we draw a third land so we're not blown up by Smash to Smithereens this game. Lunan Arbiter, not terrible. We're going to Razor Verge Thicket, make an 8th Vial. And then we're going to chain Burriton into Arbiter, into Night of Vault, into Flicker Wisp, with a path for their big creature or their Eidolon of Rhetoric. Eidolon of the Great Rivers. That said, Eidolon of the Great Rivers doesn't do anything if we get to keep our Aether Vial. So we don't want to see a smash here, so we didn't see a smash. That's great. Lightning Bolt off face. So that's 5 damage there. 2 cards, 5 damage. Down to 3 cards in hand for our opponent. Puts us on 19 from the Painful Mana base. That's something. It helps the clock, I guess. So we take 2. We're going to tick up our Vial. We drew an untapped land, which is beautiful. We're going to... What do I want to do here? Do I want to... Because the Arbiter will probably get sealed, which I'm okay with. Do you know what? Maybe I want to make the Burriton Forge Tender first. Not that I won't be saving this Arbiter from the Seal of Fire, because I think saving the Knight of Autumn would be better. But by virtue of being in play, our opponent might play worse. Let's see if that happens. Because what I'm probably going to do is just double block the Monastery Swift Spear here, which I'm required them to cast a spell and Seal of Fire my Lunan Arbiter to be able to save it. Interestingly, Knight of Autumn has a mode where it can pop the Seal of Fire. I won't be doing that. I think gain 4 life is by far the optimum choice here. I guess next turn we want to set a Seal of Fire on our Arbiter. Yeah, fine. That's fine, 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 fine. Maybe a bit hasty from our opponent, considering like we could have like a Thalia coming, for example. Untapped land. We can go Knight of Autumn, gain 4 life. We can play a Temple Garden tap, keep up Path to Exile, then make a Knight next turn. I think I like that. Minimize the damage we're taking. They're going to end step shoot us, probably. No, probably not, actually, because of the Monastery Swift Spear, all their spells are at a huge premium, so I guess they want to Dismember, or they want to Skullcrack into a burn spell to kill our Burriton Forge Tender. Although, yeah, no, they can't target it. They can prevent the damage. They want to play Skullcrack after combat. That's what they want to do. No attacks. Yeah, because the Vial being up. They could have attacked last turn, but they didn't. They should have done. They suspend a Rift Bolt. End of turn, I'm going to activate my Aether Vial to make them fetch. They did not. Okay. I see you've played this game before. If that was an arbiter, they would have got a bit screwed there. Tick up my vial. Drew another land. Sweet. Are we casting creatures and stuff this turn? Let's go forest. Night of Autumn. We're free of a Skullcrack here. Gain 4 life. Okay. No attacks, because Burrowing Forgeshender is an incredible blocker. They're going to Rift Bolt my beautiful, beautiful Night of Autumn here. Probably, maybe. Maybe they just Rift Bolt my face. Maybe they Rift Bolt my face because they need to get their big creature thingy out. So Monstrous Whisper grows, Rift Bolt goes to our face. I'm okay with that. It undoes, like, only, not even half of what Night of Autumn did. Like, Night of Autumn made a 2-1 body and gained us 4 life, and they did us 3 damage. Seal of Fire from our opponent. Yep. I'm just keeping Vial on 3 up for this, like, the rest of this game. I guess I'm going to just path the Monastery Swift Spear and start swinging. Do I do that? No, I don't think I'll do that. Tick up my vial. No, do not tick up my vial, should I say. Always no. No. Horizon Canopy. Then we're going to cast... Well, no, I'm going to crack my canopy first. Let's draw a card. Drew an Arbiter. I guess I'm just going to cast my Arbiter. I mean, it strangles their mana. No, I think Selfless Spirit's better. I don't know why they aren't cracking their fetches, honestly. If they Seal of Fire my Knight here, I just Flicker Wisp it. And then if they have another removal spell, we've at least fogged one of them. Do they have a Bolt here? They are going to crack a fetch. Would I save my knight from a bolt here? That is a question. Probably. They're going to skull crack to stop us from gaining life. Okay, so. Swift Spear grows. Skull crack resolves. I cannot prevent damage this turn, and people cannot gain life. Whisper Trigger resolves, taking the knight out. 2 damage does nothing. Selfless Spirit resolves. Go to combat. Attack them for 1. They can't really block it because it's got protection from red. But really, I mean, they just cannot. And then my knight's going to come back. It's just going to be a. It's going to get counters this turn because we can't gain life. So. And I can double block sack my spirit if I wanted to like kill the Swift Spear. If I wanted to, I probably won't. I will let them with 2 cards in hand swing without Swift Spear. They do not want to. Cool. We've also got the sack of the Burrowing Forgeshender too. We've got a very good board state right now. We're gonna untap and draw a Gavinny Township, which is also a very good magic card. Do I just attack and Gavinny? Yeah, probably. They're gonna block my knight, I guess. They're gonna lightning bolt myself, the spirit, which will die regardless of what happens here. So we're just gonna sacrifice it. Give all my creatures indestructible. Maybe I should have burrowed into that. Hard to say. Now they block the Knight of Autumn. No blocks. Okay. Gavinny Township. 11 damage. Take them to 6. Vile on 3. Path, the shields are down. So if they have a... But then the Chandra's Incinerator thingy, or whatever the hell it's called, plus a burn spell doesn't really do much this turn with Boat and Fortune in play. Skew the critics to shoot my Flicker Wisp, eh? Do I want my Wisp to result survive? Probably. Sack this. Target the skewer. Wisp survives. This way, if they attack, they just die. They cannot attack. Let's scoop it up. Cool. We got there. Game one was rough with a bit of a slow draw, but game two and three, we had like all the tricksy like anti-burn tech we needed. Sweet. We have won the die roll. So I'd love to play first. And can't keep that. And can't keep that. Oh, round one went so well. I guess we need to get one of our mulligans to 5 out of the way this league. That's mulligan again. And we're going to keep this dreadful hand. And just draw creatures, I guess. Let's bottom the forest and an Eldrazi temple. Done. Opponents kept 7. That's not great. Okay, we're going to play the Aether Vial of an Eldrazi temple. This is going to suggest them were black, white, and taxes. Black, white, Eldrazi, and taxes. It's not common to see the green, white version play the Eldrazi temples. I have on many occasions in the past, but I'm also kind of what you might call a death and taxes stan. Or fanboy. This is going to be an Inquisition taking our only action spell. Oof! Yikes, as the kids would say in response to a magic artist admitting that they are a predator. We lost the path, so that's not great. Hopefully we'll just draw bodies from now on. Then keeping 7 and possibly being like an attrition style deck, Death Shadow or Jund, means that we've probably lost this round already. Bit disheartening. But that is how the cookie crumbles, or how magic plays. You might also describe it as. Is magic a cookie? Is the gameplay a crumble? These are all things that we will find out over the course of the next couple of rounds of magic. We drew a Noble Hierarch, which we're going to make in their end step, or make in response to a Thoughtseize. And then have it die to a removal spell, probably. Would I rather this Death Shadow or Jund? I guess I'd rather this be Death Shadow because our like Containment Priest plus Flicker Plan is much better against Death Shadow than this Jund, I guess, because they play very few threats. And what are we going to get from our opponent here? I'm refilled. I'm refilling water every round, so I'm now sipping a iced water. Do we refer to iced water as iced water? With some slice of lime in it? Yep. I am a man of culture and... I was going to say exotic tastes, but A, that sounds problematic, some would say, and B, I don't know if slice of lime is that exotic. That's why I did sip that very loudly, because people have said they don't like it in the past. And if I've learned anything about my life on the internet, is that you don't tell people the things you don't like. People often send me unsolicited astrolabe pictures, because I'm not a big fan of astrolabe. I'm going to violate my noble hierarch here. That's supposed to be conventional, traditional Jund. What doesn't kill the Tarmogoyf makes it stronger. I guess, yeah. But your opponent mulligan to 5 doesn't kill Tarmogoyf, and it probably makes the Tarmogoyf stronger too. So, checks out. Checks out. I'm going to tick up my vial. We're going to draw a powerful spell. That is a relatively powerful spell. I'm going to path them in their draw step. Or at some point during their turn. Not going to do it now. Whilst it allows us to Noble Hierarch them for 1, it will also allow them to untap with 4 mana, which might mean they Bloodbraid Elf until Hycologan's Command and we just lose on the spot. Or they could be like real old school and play something really exciting like an Olivia Voldaren or Huntmaster of the Fells. Do you remember those years and days and many months ago when people played Olivia Voldarens and Huntmaster of the Fells and Jund? Do you remember that? God, I remember. Liliana of the Vale comes down. Ticks up, I assume. Yep. We're going to now path the Goyf. What doesn't kill the Tarmogoyf makes it stronger, but what doesn't kill it sometimes just sends it to the Naughty Step, the Exile Zone, the place where it can be processed by a Wasteland Strangler, if that was your kink. Goyf is gone. Goyf is dead. Goyf is more than dead. Goyf is double dead. Is the Exile Zone double dead? Is it more dead? Is it deader? Is it a different kind of dead? Is, like, the graveyard, like, dead, if you believe in an afterlife, because you can come back from it a lot of time? Whilst Exile is more the atheist's idea of being dead? Is this the kind of thing you want to talk about today? Or hear talked about in a Magic video? Probably not. So, Liliana's a problem. We're hardly threatening her with our lowly noble hierarch. We're going to take up our vial here, so hopefully we can instant speed up Blade Splicer next turn. If we draw one. Talia, Guardian of Thraben. Okay, let's play her. Thalia's kind of crap in this matchup, honestly. Do I sideboard her out? It used to be a time when you'd sideboard out your vials because of just the critical mass of Abrupt Decays and Colligan's Commands and similar. Do I do that now? Probably. You probably want more impactful spells than the vial that gets blown up, like, tangentially by half the Colligan's Command. Tangentially? That's not the word I wanted. Coincidentally? On the side of? Just by chance? I don't know. I don't know. My rambling is a way to deal with my Mulligan to 5. Yep, I'm one of those people. I'm uncomfortable or unhappy. I guess I just talk a load of sugar puffs and then see where we go from there. Raging Ravine from our opponent. Lightning Bolt on Noble Hierarch from our opponent. Down to Liliana from our opponent, I assume now. And then if one of the last cards is a Goyf. No, it's not. So there are two cards in hand. But they haven't played a body is both good and bad. If they play a body, well, we need a way to deal with it or to race it. If they don't play a body, it means they've probably got a handful of removal. So again, Blade Splicer is our best card. The reason I mention Blade Splicer again is that Blade Splicer makes two bodies and makes it very hard for Jund to deal with. That's a magic card that I can't cast. Wish it was an Eldrazi Angel. That is a sentence I've never said before because it makes me sick to my stomach. But god damn it, I wish that was an Eldrazi Angel right now. Okay, so we're going to lose Shalai to the Liliana of the Veil uptick, and then we're going to draw Eternal Witness. It's Pedascard's card. Yep. Goodbye, Shalai. Quite useful in this matchup. Doesn't die to Bolt. Turns off the downtick of Liliana. Turns off all the other removal spells on our creatures, except for, well, they can obviously Assassin Trophy or terminate Shalai herself. Activate Raging Ravine, and they get in for 4. Okay, we don't have a Ghost Quarter to get rid of this. We have an Eldrazi Temple instead. Okay, we don't. So the only things we don't want to draw, I guess, are lands that aren't Horizon Canopy and Restoration Angels. And what that now allows the Cosmic Fates and Gods to do is give me a Horizon Canopy that I crack to draw a Restoration Angel. Because, yeah. Is Renin 6 still legal in this format? I forget where things are legal anymore because Magic is such a confusing mess. I'm not going to take up because 3 is the sweet spot. We drew a Wisp. That is certainly something that we can vial in and take out that Raging Ravine. They have one card in hand, they have a card in the bank for Nurturing Peatland, and they're drawing in their draw step, so they have access to 3 cards this turn. They're thinking. They're gonna activate Liliana. I'm gonna activate my Vial in response. If we don't have removal for Flicker Wisp, this is really good. There's a small chance. We're gonna bring in Wisp here and flicker out the Raging Ravine to stop us from getting attacked. If we don't have removal, Flicker Wisp can also kill Liliana. They're thinking, so maybe they have a K command here so they can blow up the Vial and make us discard. Sorry, excuse me. Yeah, that's game winning. I don't want to continue playing this game. Oh my goodness. Colligan's Command is a card that, whilst I don't think it shouldn't exist, not at all. It's not an astral abe or anything. It does upset me. It's a card that's very, very good against all the things that I hold dear. It's just a very, very powerful fair magic card. Probably one of the most powerful fair magic cards put in a very, very long time. Scavenging Ooze to get an Eye of Zendikar. Collect Oof is bad. Bowden Fortune just stops bolts and Raging Ravines and Cacoban damages, I guess. I probably just want to cut my Vials and maybe my Thalias. We are on the play, so Thalia's remarkably better on the play. Remarkably better. Silver Spirit's really good, I need to bring that in. Rest in Peace is pretty good against Goyfs as well, and the K-Man to a lesser extent. So we'll bring that in. Okay. That's our 60. Maybe I should keep the Thalion on the play and Cutter on the draw. I'm unsure, but I'm definitely going to take the Vials out. Obviously, they're great, like getting ahead and everything. Again, much, much better on the play. But, yeah, just get having them blown up by a K-Command feels pretty rough. Let's keep this. We're going to have our Dork killed. And then we just need to draw some lands. We've kept the 7. Our opponents kept the 7 as well. Horizon Canopy, Noble Hierarch, pass the turn. Next turn we can go either Eldrazi Displacer or Containment Priest. Now, Priest in this matchup doesn't do a whole lot. They don't have, unless they're playing Kroxa. I mean, they might be playing Kroxa, that's a possibility. But beyond Kroxa, I can't really think of anything else that Jund might be playing, unless it turns out they're a Loam deck. It was very, very misleading. But Containment Priest just ends up being a card that is going to combo, if you will, or synergize with Eldrazi Displacer. That's it. So Verdant Catacombs is cracked here. We're going to see probably an Inquisition, Thoughtseize, a Bolt, or Fatal Push. Blood Crypt untapped. Bolt the Bird. There we go. Noble Hierarch, the Dork, dies. We untap and we draw a Noble Hierarch. I'm going to play it here. Basically, if they don't kill this, and they like deploy a threat, like a Tarmogoyf or something, if we untap and draw a land, we get to play Gideon. We're hugely ahead, and a massive advantage. If we don't do that, then we're not. if we don't do that, the opposite is true. No, but yeah, Gideon is really, really good. Raging Ravine here. I'm hoping we see nothing from them, but a Bolt, Fatal Push, Inquisition, or Inquisition will be fine. They take our Displacer or our Containment Priest and leave us to untap, draw a land, and play a Gideon. Okay, they're thinking about it. Don't forget that Restoration Angel is a non-bow with our Containment Priest. Or an anti-synergy. An anti-sin. A non-sin? No sin. I don't know. There's got to be a portmanteau or... if non-bow exists, then there's got to be a synergistic variant or equivalent, right? They're thinking long and hard. Okay, nothing from them. God damn it, I really hope we draw a land here. No land, but we can play an Arbiter. I think we do. Now, the reason they may not have bolted or pushed the Hierarch there and thought long and hard is if they know the matchup well, that we might be playing an Arbiter plus a land next, like land into Arbiter into Ghost Quarter them. So ghost quartering them here might be terrible because they might actually have a removal spell for the Arbiter. So we cannot just strip mine them here. So what they did last turn, where I didn't kill this and thought long and hard, is now making me second guess myself. Or not second guess myself, is play very differently to what I would have done if they just, like, you know, tapped out for a Goyf. So I am not going to ghost quarter them. However, if they like go to bolt the Arbiter, then we obviously ghost quarter them. Also, ghost quartering them puts us further away from the Gideon plan, and Gideon's our best plan. Now, this will hopefully mess with their fetch land. So if they've got a fetch land now into a Liana, that'd be nice. And a land allows us to save our resto our Arbiter too, so we can like protect it from them going end of turn, bolt the Arbiter, attempt to fetch, for example. A lot of back and forth here. We really want a third land. Nothing from our opponent. They're missing a land drop going to second main phase. They're playing a land in their second main phase to really excite me, and then no, okay, they're not. They're not. Okay, so they've missed a land drop, which is fantastic for us. Because right now they can't like kill my Arbiter without me ghost quartering them. Okay, so we did not draw a fourth land. So we're going to get in with an Arbiter, which is going to be exalted thanks to the Hierarch and become a 3-3. Someone is grinding metal in the distance, so I'm sorry if you can hear that on the mic. Not a lot I can do about that. I might have to close my window in a second. They go 11. 14, sorry. We're then going to pay one life and get shot and play a rest in peace, because it don't make any drawn Goyfs a lot worse, and Renin 6 worse, if that's a thing. That's is it even still legal in Modern? I know it's banned in Legacy because I got excited. Modern banned list, Renin 6 is still legal, right? Because Renin 6 and Oko and all these cards being banned in different formats and not other formats makes it very confusing when you take a little break from a format. Yeah, so Renin 6 was worse with rest in peace. So this turns off rest in peace. This turns off one of the modes of Cloggins Command. Turns off one of the modes of rest of Renin 6, and it also makes Goyf a 0/1. People often, I feel, undervalue or underestimate how good rest in peace is against Jund. Oh, Inquisition of Kozilek. Okay. I assume they take the Displacer, not the Containment Priest. Containment Priest is just a bear. A flash bear. In this case. Yep, Displacer seems a lot the better pick there. So are they holding up Bolt? That is the question we have to ask ourselves. So no third land drop. We are getting lucky here. We're going to draw another. That's a pretty good land to draw there, honestly. I'm not going to. I'll take this. The Malignant 5 game one felt bad, but this feels like pretty good, honestly. If they don't have Bolt, we just strip them of all their lands. But I think I just slam Gideon. Oh, I guess I can slam Resto. But if I slam Gideon, I can go for the strip mines next turn. Gideon's really good. Gideon's so good. Yeah, I have to slam Gideon. It's also good if they go untapped land into Liliana here as well. Like, what's that? They don't have a clean answer to kill the Gideon plus the token, so we always get some value out of it. Yeah, they had the Bolt that we thought they did. It enables a fetch line next turn, but so we played around the Bolt pretty well, honestly. They can now play a fetch land. Now, they would have had the fetch land and played it. Like, if they had it in hand, they would have played it the turn before. So they've just drawn a third land there. Tapping out for a Liliana doesn't seem too good. What kills Gideon these days? We've got Dismember. I'm sure there's also like a recently printed black card that takes counters off. Heartless Thing from Ikoria. There's also something that takes off Indestructible recently printed too. I'm sure there is. Renin 6, as we thought. So they're going to kill our Noble Hierarch with that. Yep, Noble Hierarch dies. What's the Heartless Act do? Three counters off target creatures. I'm going to take loyalty off of it, but it won't kill. It won't kill our Gideon there. So our Knight Ally can try and kill the Renin 6, and Gideon can try and chunk them, or we can just chunk them in general. Also, we draw a land, we get Restoration Angel, which is pretty strong. We did not. Make a Gideon. Go to combat attack. We're going to go ahead and attack them with Gideon and Renin 6 of the 2-2. They have a bolt for the knight, saving the Ren. I don't think I mind. Nope, no bolt, no push. We're going to hold up Containment Priest. I guess the option of the upside of playing like a load of Restoration Angels and Containment Priest that you can play at instant speed even if they are. Because this hand looks very anti-synergistic, right? Wood of Foothills. Yeah, so we might see a Bloodbraid Elf here or some other hideous 4-drop. Bloodbraid Elf into a bolt actually kills Gideon. Actually, yeah, I was trying to figure out what Jun's clean answers to Gideon are, and I guess Bloodbraid Elf into the correct spell, would that be a K-Command, a bolt, or similar, is that answer. That's pretty unfortunate if this Bloodbraid Elf hits one of those. Can you just hit like a... Okay, real bad. So it's three from the Bloodbraid Elf here. Oh, we can Containment Priest to block the Bloodbraid Elf, actually. So they're going to kill our knight. And make us discard a Restoration Angel, which they know of one of our restos. Bloodbraid Elf lands. I assume it attacks the Gideon, or is it going to be a blocker for the Gideon? It's going to be a blocker for the Gideon. Okay. Yeah, I forgot about our Flash Containment Priest in hands. That wasn't so bad. We're going to make a Containment Priest. Oh, they have to, because otherwise Gideon kills them. I forget they're on 5. Gordon Bennett, sometimes magic is hard, right? Sometimes magic is hard. Oh, okay. So we just path this up to Gideon and kill them, and we go to game 3. Okay, cool. We got there. Game 3. That makes Fizz going into Bloodbraid Elf, but that's about it. Do I want a Burrowed Forge Chandler in this matchup? Blocks Bloodbraid Elf all day long as well. Is it better than anything else that I've brought in? Eternal Witness, perhaps? Eternal Witness is good against Jund, but not when you have a rip in play. That's the thing. Probably better than a Containment Priest, honestly. If we're honest about it. Actually, you know what? I think... No, I guess Disposal Plus Containment Priest is very grindy. So if we get that online against Jund, but that means you have to like play through multiple removal spells. So probably, honestly, in retrospective, we probably should be playing our Thalias over our Containment Priests anyway. This hand is slow. They've kept a 7. We're going to keep this. We're going to bottom that temple. Okay. Turn 1. What are we going to see from our opponent? Inquisition, Thoughtseize, Tapland, Hex Drinker. Inquisition. Cool. So they'll take the Arbiter or the Path here, I think. If they have a removal for the Arbiter, they'll take the Path. They don't have removal in hand then, or they're really scared of the Arbiter. Hierarch will be good. Oh. Wish I said it before it come up. It seems like I was just pretending. Hierarch would have been good there. Hierarch, this turn into Arbiter Ghost Walk next turn would have been gas, because you can. It's like a nut draw. It's one of the best draws the deck has. And but we can't do that, because they took our Arbiter. Maybe that's why they took the Arbiter, in case we drew Hierarch. Maybe that's the reason. Flickering Blade Slices is going to be pretty hot against them, honestly. If this is Renin 6, we might just lose the game. It's that bad for us. So, I was saying earlier where I don't believe K-Command should not exist. This shouldn't exist. This is a card that I think is just absolutely absurd. Like, it feels like when they were designing it, they must have been smoking a bowl of, like, crystal meth. Do you smoke crystal meth? I don't even know if that's a thing. They must have been smoking a bowl of something. Like, I don't know. Like a bowl of kittens, like, on fire, and they're just huffing the fumes. I'm not just saying that because it's backbreaking here. Well, it is backbreaking here. Like, we probably don't come back from that. But it's just like, why? Why is this a thing? Oh my goodness. But less moaning. I'm still enjoying it. I'm enjoying Modern in spite of the existence of a couple of cards that are just quite frankly unreasonable. What is our opponent's follow-up? If they don't have a follow-up to the Renin 6, if the rest of their deck are like bricks a little bit and they draw badly, then we have a chance. If the rest of the deck performs as it should do off the bat, yeah, like that's not good. That's not good at all. I guess I'm going to ditch the path because I don't have threats right now. And then next turn we need to draw a white source. Otherwise, we might have to ghost quarter ourselves to get a blade splice into play, which they can kill one half of it with this and one half of it with this. God. This is why part of me wonders, like, oh, is it still legal? White source? Nope. Okay, our mana base is also folded itself. We mulligan to six. Our dork got blanked by this, and they cut. They're now hitting all the land drops. And we did not hit the mana to be able to play. Well, playing Wisp doesn't do anything, actually, to be fair. Okay, fair play, Spicer. This will request that both of their planeswalkers tick down to deal with it. So it's probably the best we've got. I guess landing a Shalai next turn, if they get greedy, they tick up and we discard the Flicker Wisp. They tick up and they're running six. And they don't do something else with the other, like, you know, three or four cards in their hand. There was a time when Jund was, like, one of the worst matchups for these style of decks that I like to play. And then things got better. And then things got remarkably worse at a certain time. Okay, so they down take both their Planeswalkers. God, Planeswalker design is so much fun, isn't it? I'm really glad that's part of Magic. Scavenging Ooze. Landing into Shalai is the only way we get back into this. Nah, this is unwinnable. Let's go to round three. Okay, risking it for the biscuit with a one lander into Noble Hierarch can sometimes work. But if you look at our lead up is a three drop, a three drop, and 2-4 drops. So this hand is literal garbage. This hand is fine. It's fine. I don't want to put any of these cards back, quite frankly. Two drop into three drop is pretty good. I'm probably going to put back Knight of Autumn, which I'm probably going to regret now when I find out like there's some form of Hardened Scales Affinity or Urza deck or similar. But, you know, I think these three cards work together collectively to beat the most amount of strategies, I think. I guess it's not going to put Blaze by the back, but Blaze is just good at making, you know, a lot of bodies with a Displacer as well. Or maybe there's Storm and all of these cards don't do anything. Scald and Time from our opponent. One of the first ones that strikes the most fear into my heart in contemporary Magic. Mainly because it could be any number of combo decks, but also it could just be any of the Snow decks. Haggle, discarding cards. Is this Dredge? Oh, my. Oof, okay. Here we go. Containment Priest, it's your time to shine, my friend. So they're going to Dredge Stinkweed Imp now. They didn't Dredge. Oh, we're trying to hit another land drop. I'm with you. I'm with you. That makes sense. Rage of Urge Thicket. Let's pass the turn to our opponent. They're going to draw. Dredging seems bad. Yep. Land. Yep. They've got a loam, I assume, in hand. Red, black. What's this? Cathartic Reunion. Now they're going to dredge. Let's allow them to dredge. Okay. Lots of dredging. But no sign of an Archimede. Oh, creeping chills. Ouch, ouch, ouch. Okay, we're going to take six here, which is fine. They aren't making any bodies yet. We're going to make a Containment Breeze next. I'm just going to flash it in. There's no Cathartic Reunion in the graveyard. Maybe I should protect it by... like, if they could... They can Ox next turn, but they can't if a Containment Priest. I have a Containment Priest. The only reason I'm thinking otherwise is simply because if they go Cathartic Reunion next turn to kill it, and then for turn after, they can, like, go wild. We're going to untap, draw a Razor Verge Thicket. Cool. I guess now we're going to go Blade Splicer or Displacer. Displacer. Okay, let's attack. Main board Containment Priest seems pretty good against them. I guess Cathartic Reunion, not Cathartic Reunion, Conflagrate. I think I was saying the wrong word a minute ago. Conflagrate, the X damage spell where they discard cards to shoot me. That's probably their best bet. Creeping Chill's going to shoot us for three again, padding out their life total. Bloodghast in the graveyard. Land will bring that back, but Containment Priest will exile it if they choose to do that. So they really need Lightning Axes and Conflagrates here, and they don't have them, which is sweet. We now untap. We have Gathering Township in place. We now have protection for our Containment Priest against removal spells. So I guess we just hammer them for five every turn now. Actually, I assume, like, the Containment Priest doesn't exile itself. I assume it doesn't, because when you put it off on Omniscience, it doesn't stop the opponent putting something in as well. So I assume it doesn't. We're going to keep up protection for our Containment Priest because it will just win us the game here. They can't really do anything bar conflagrating us. Again, they dredge the loam. Are they going to cast a loam here? They need to hit land drops, don't they? And like fill their hand up for a conflagrate. But nothing from them. If we hit a land, we can Gavany if we don't have to draw a Displacer. Okay, we're going to go into attacking. Another 5, take them to 12. 3 turn clock. They're going to dredge. They're going to hit an Archimede. They're going to choose not to put it in, I assume. Yep. Are they trying to get to 11 cards in hand eventually? Is that their plan? But then they have to mana to do that. I don't know what their plan here is. Drew a Restoration Angel. So we're going to attack for 5. Take them to 7. Then we're going to flash in Resto at the end of their turn and not flicker anything. Untap and kill them. Obviously, if they have Lightning Axe, that's bad. Are they even playing Lightning Axe main board anymore in Dredge? Okay, they Dredge. They hit 2 more Narcomoebas. Is Lightning Axe even instant speed? I want to go over to Goldfish and look at like your average dredge list in Modern right now, because it's been a while. It's been a hot minute. Dredge. Conflagrate. Dangerous Wager. Discard your hand and draw 2 cards. That's new. Okay. Do I get blown out if I go for this? I guess Creeping Chill us down to 8 and then Conflagrate us for 8 would be a plan. They have to ditch it. It takes them 3 mana to do that, though, so they can't. We're going to bring in Rest in Peace. Selfless Spirit because of Conflagrate. And Bowden Forge Tender because of the Conflagrate. The sideboard is going to definitely have lightning axes in it, and it might have conflict gates as well. And looking at goldfish, maybe dark blasts. And what is bad against dredging our main board? Guess Eternal Witness isn't too hot. Whisper's a tad bit slow. But it does kill them in the air. Oh, it gets blocked by Narka, maybe it's not good. Is that where we're at? Yeah, I think that's where we're at. Arbiter and Containment Priest being some of our best cards here. Okay, our opponent is choosing to play first. Okay. They mulligan to six. We're going to keep this. Arbiter's very good against their like loam fetch land plan. Mulligan to five. Okay. Guess they want to try and like kill off our graveyard hate. Or I guess now with Containment Priest, they have to deal with both Rest in Pieces, Ley Lines, and Containment Priests. So they've got to have really be versatile in terms of like what hate they anti-hate they mulligan to. Conflagrate into the bin. Sure. We're going to untap and draw a Razor Witch Thicket. We're going to play a Temple Card tapped. Pass the turn. If they loam here to grab a fetch land, then we play Arbiter next turn. If they don't loam here, we play Thalia. Burton Forge Tender. Sweet. How do I sequence this? I want to get Thalia, Arbiter, and Burton Forge Tender to play to, like, to all like protect and muck around with our opponent's mana. They got a Scald Tundra, they're gonna crack. I just slam the Arbiter. Yeah, maybe I do. The reason I play the Ghost Quarter here is in case we draw another Ghost Quarter next turn and there's like a window for us to double strip mine them. They crack the Tarn in response, so we didn't get them, as it were. They get a Blood Crypt tapped. Here's the battlefield. They got no dredges in the bin. If they go Lightning Axe, kill the Arbiter, dredger into the bin, that'd be good for them. They did not. They got to their two lands of the green source, so they have got that online, but they need to also get the dredger in the bin. So loam would be good for them here. Apart from that, they can't crack the tarn. Also tapping it or casting loam, getting tarn back and playing tarn means that we can ghost quarter them. Conflagrate for two, discarding Ox and Narc Amoeba. Well, there's nothing I can do about it. So maybe leading with Thalia would have been good. We've got two cards in hand. Razor Verge Thicket. Thalia. Burriton. I mean, Conflagrate is one of the best cards they have against us. So to have it used so early to kill a disruptive element is really good for us. If, what we ideally want to do now, just so we understand at home, is draw a Scavenging Ooze, a Containment Priest, or a Rest in Peace. Any of our real strong hate, but I mean, we can probably maneuver to a win through what we've got here as well. We want to deploy something this turn, so we're not going to play the Canopy. We're going to go Plains, keep up a white source. We're going to go to combat and attack for three, taking them to 16. No flash threat problems from our opponent. And then I guess we just play a Knight of Autumn and make it a big old Knight of Autumn, like a strong, like an ox. Like imagine if this was an ox riding a plant horse. Cool. So no dredger in the bin, so they're not going to be able to ox this turn. A lot of ox talk, isn't there? Do you know in England, like one of our gravy granule like brands is OXO? Interesting, isn't it? Celebros shoots them for one. They cast Cathartic Reunion for three mana. They do get to ditch a Stinkweed Imp here, which means they are setting up for ox next turn, I guess. They hit a Creeping Chill, which is going to pad out their life total. Hit two Creeping Chills. And a Blood Ghast in the bin as well. Two Blood Ghasts in the bin. Really padding on the life total. No land drop for our opponent, though. Okay. Well, I guess. Yeah. We're going to go to combat. We're going to attack. Rest in Peace costs three mana, by the way, so we can't double spell here, unfortunately. But I think that's just like. I mean, it's greed for me to be like, oh, unfortunately, we can't do this. We're just going to go ahead and slam that. Like, there's no two ways about it. Sometimes you want to lure them in. This time round, we wanted to get rid of the ox. Okay, round three was a quick one. Turns out all our hateful cards. Hate bears is going to hate, I guess. Although I prefer if you don't call it hate bears, call it green, white, deafening taxes. That's a much more, I don't know, hate bears just feels like it's not very good. I don't know why, the stigma. But I guess D&T and Modern's got that stigma already. Whatever. And it's time for round four. I have won the die roll. I would love to play first. Oh yeah. We've got some cards in the bank with Horizon Canopy, but we do have Ghost Quarter to go alongside Alien Arbiter. I'm going to give it a shot. I can't believe I'm just giving a 5-lander, 6-lander. This is absurd. I've probably done the wrong thing. But we are on the play. So we've got the advantage of going first. One less card than our opponent. But we have two in the bank with Horizon Canopies. Also, it might just be like Arbiter turn two on the play. Might mess with our opponent's mana enough for us to draw into stuff. Now, if we draw more lands, that's a problem. But yeah. So probably shouldn't have kept this. But it's so hot here. Then, you know, that's just... I'm going to blame the heat. If I make a mistake, I'm blaming the heat. Our opponent is still considering whether they keep their 7. What is that? Hell's Caretaker. That's it. That profile picture there, the Hell's Caretaker thing, is one of the creepier magic cards, I reckon, honestly. They're keeping 7 as well. So, we're going to lead with a Temple Garden tapped. Next turn, we can go Razor Verge Thicket into Arbiter or Ghost Court into Arbiter, depending on how we feel. Probably could have gone Razor Verge Thicket there instead of the Temple, actually, so we can get Razor Verge Thicket plus Ghost Quarter or Razor Verge into Razor Verge. The way that I'm sequencing now might mean that one of our Razor Verges might be tapped later down the line. Verdant Cat comes from our opponent. They crack it. Love this to be Dredge again. Forest. Arbor Elf. Okay, turns out that perhaps our whole Arbiter plan might not be very good. If they are straight up elves or Ponza, neither of those things seem great for us. Let's just go ahead and slam an Arbiter. Hopefully their hand is full of fetch lands and cords and he does some work. We drew a Wisp, so we were on our first step to making my very wonky keep not so bad. 3 mana. If we see a Blood Moon here, we are screwed. Utopia Sprawl, so we can flicker that out with our Flicker Wisp next turn. Old Ghost Quarter, even. Red, green. Oh no. Lightning Bolt plus Blood Moon might be game over. Yeah, okay. Our mana base is relatively greedy. We want to draw like a Forest into Noble Hierarch, I guess, perhaps. Maybe that's where our best bet would be. Vile is not terrible. Vile is not terrible. The great thing about Vile is that once we get our Flicker Wisp out of the Vile, we can flicker out the Blood Moon and then utilize our lands. Probably should be just slamming down Horizon Canopy to get to that state, I guess. So Vile wasn't terrible. We're not so soft to Blood Moon if we have access to our basics, obviously, our Hierarchs, or our Vials. Now, it depends upon their follow-up. So their follow-up of Torch Defiance is very, very good. Not quite Glorybringer good, but it's pretty good. The exile card on top of the library, found a Blood Moon. They're not going to play it. They're going to shoot us for 2, get 18. Get attacked by an Arbor Elf, I assume. Yay, nay. Yep, okay. Go to 17. Untap. And draw. A Wisp. Not the worst, honestly. Not the worst. We're going to be getting zapped for a minimum of 3 every turn if they don't draw something godly, like a Storm Breath or a Glorybringer or... heaven forbid, Inferno Titan. I don't think they play Inferno Titans in Ponza anymore. Green red mana based prison. Green red land destruction. Whatever you want to call it. They have access to 2 green thanks to the Arbor Elf plus the forest. And they have red off of the Utopia Spawn and the 2 mountains they've got. I guess keeping a handful of like 6 non basic lands, 2 of which we're going to use to get out of our flood, and then them Blood Mooning us. That's not a great pairing. Name a more iconic duo than keeping a land heavy hand and getting Blood Mooned. Two red mana from Chandra. Aye. Is this gonna be an Inferno Titan? Nope, Blood Void Elf. Okay. into a scavenging ooze. Well, that's a lot of pressure. That's a Laura Laura pressure, as Cilla Black once would have said if talking about Magic the Gathering. Arbrevel taps the forest. This is going to be a second Bloodbraid Elf. Oh, just a casual cloth this, which is online. Okay. Okay. Take three. Tick up our vial. Draw a two drop, which we can vial in to block the scavenging ooze and feel bad, or block the Bloodwood Elf and save some damage. Yeah, that's the plan. Leon Arbiter is going to be a literal cat Jesus, just going straight on the crucifix. That crucifix being Bloodbraid Elf's boot. Cloth is exiled on Leon Arbiter. I guess we can kill the scavenging ooze here then instead. Otherwise, if we kill the Bloodbraid Elf, the scavenging ooze just gets much, much better. So there's a whole bunch of damage coming in. Arbiter, go to blocks. Chandra, everyone's on its way. This being a bolt of some description, not even an abrade is bad. Abrading our vial, a stomp. Okay. So next time we can vial our Blood Moon, cast another Flicker Wisp, flicker our Wisp, take some of theirs out for a turn, crack one of our canopies. No, the Razor Witch Sticker, I didn't play. The Razor Witch Sticker gonna be a mountain, so we'll come and play untapped. We're on three, by the way, so we've got to do something pretty special. Season Pyromancer in the Exile Zone. They can't cast it. They can't tap the forest and untap it with Arbor Elf during the activation of Chandra. Because that's how Arbor Elf works. Arbor Elf is not a mana ability, so they can't do it whilst this is on the stack. They had to float the mana if they wanted to. Well, they should have used this for the stomp. Untapped it. And I went from there. Another Arbroath. Okay. We're on one. Okay. I chose not to take up, by the way, because I'm an idiot. But what I was really thinking, I was thinking, A, I'm hungry. And B, that we won't win that game, so it's more just a drawing a card to see what happens. And then I just drift off in the tank thinking about how hungry I was and how I haven't ate properly today. Just realised. Okay, Knight of Autumns for the Blood Moons. Burrington Forge Center seems pretty good. Gideon seems good if we can get it going. I guess Damping Sphere stops the whole thingamabob, right? I think. That's how that works, Metopia Spore. I guess there's one way to really find out, is to give it a shot. Containment Priest doesn't do anything here. Whispers of Eternal Witness out, maybe. Whispers are hard to cast through moons. Maybe we'll go down on those. Right! Well, play first. I would love to play first. And we cannot keep that. We cannot keep this either. It's slow, it's cumbersome. We can Ghost Quarter ourselves to get a basic. That seems so bad. That began with seven cards. And we need a vial or an art or a hierarch, honestly. Mulligan one more time. Wow, no lander. Mulligan again. Okay, let's give this a shot. Three cards in the bottom of our library. Resto, Gideon, and a Temple Garden on the bottom. Yeah, casting green spells is overrated. I just want a basic land versus Blood Moon. Okay, we'd mold to four. They're going to play a Dork next turn. We're going to untap and play Thalia. Then we're going to untap and play Damping Sphere. Oh no, we have to play Damping Sphere first unless we draw a land. Because Thalia makes Damping Sphere cost more. Oof. Oof. That hurts. That's painful. So, Sprawl turn one. Okay. So that makes Dampening Sphere better. We drew a Razor Ridge Thicket. Let's just go Dampening Sphere. Yeah, so this forest now just produces one colorless, right? If tapped for. It taps only for colorless, I think. I don't think they even get the green out of it. They shock themselves. Wait, they tap for four mana and they get. Wait. Whenever Enchanted Forest is tapped for mana, its controller adds an additional one mana of the chosen color. Oh, it doesn't go onto the forest. It's not the ability on the forest. Okay. Fair enough. Fair enough. I thought it was an ability of the forest itself, but it's not. So Damping Sphere only slows them down marginally. Okay, so this turn, I'm going to play Thalia. Next turn, I'm going to Ghost Court their forest. That's my game plan. It's so bad. We want to draw another white source so we can flick our Ghost Quarter out and then Ghost Quarter on end step. We don't want to follow up with a Pillage or similar now. That would suck. They hit their fourth land drop, didn't play anything. Okay. We can just, if we draw a land, we can just Wisp out the forest, honestly. That might be an option as well. That's probably better. We drew Path to Exile. Not good. Let's go to combat and attack. They have five cards in hand. They have a Stomp or a Braid. Yeah. Yeah. Seems good. Seems good. Just literally my mouth is open. Just keep excreting into it. Just pouring human excrement right into my gaping maw. This is a thrashing. We're getting absolutely wrecked with a capital R. This is a giant. No, it's not. It's worse than the giant. It's a Bloodbraid Elf into a Lightning Bolt, which they cannot cast thanks to the. Wait, what? One, two, three, four. Four mana. How did they. Am I being an idiot? Am I being an idiot? They have one, two, three, four, five mana. Four mana for Bloodbraid. How did they do that? Was that a mistake? Was that wrong? I'm gonna screenshot that right now, just so I can show my Discord and like get a judge to tell me I'm being a moron, I guess. Okay. Take a damage, see what we draw. It's land. Let's go. Flicker Wisp. So I've learned the Damping Sphere doesn't work the way I think it does with the Utopia Sprawl. But I'm almost certain if they played one, two, three, four mana for the Bloodbraid Elf. The next. Oh, of course! God damn it, Vince, you idiot. The Lightning Bolt only costs them one mana, like one colorless mana. They don't have to pay for it. It's Cascade, Vince. The spell is free. God, the idea of having to pay rates for Cascade would be ridiculous. So, yeah, that definitely works. For those at home who are like. So, some people are like, Vince, you're being an idiot. And I was being an idiot. For those that don't know, Cascade, as you saw earlier in the Jund match, doesn't cost them mana. We all know this. I know this. I'm just getting incredibly hot and flustered. So, the Bolt cost them nothing, but it did cost them one colorless because of Damping Sphere. So Damping Sphere did a bit of work, but not enough work. They're going to play a Bone Crusher Giant this turn, attack us for three. I'm going to trade my Wisp off for the Bloodbraid Elf. Maybe halve the Bone Crusher, take two, give my land. And then hope to draw spells where they draw lands. That's literally our only option here. But this game is not looking good. Utopia Sprawl ended up being very, very good for them. Very, very good for them. And our cards didn't interact with it in the way that we wanted it to. You know what? Oh, they have a second stomp. Nice. They play a two mana Arbor Elf, which ups their mana count. Cool. Take three. Sure. What can we even draw here is any good? Another path? That's not good. That's trash. We can double path them in their turn, which will get rid of two Bone Crusher Giants and take four. We'll get rid of a Bloodbraid Elf and a Bone Crusher Giant taking two. And then we need to draw a body that can deal with a bone crusher giant, maybe like a splicer, for example. Blood moon. Blood moon, blood moon, blood moon. Blood moon resolves. I'm just going to path this now. Yeah, I don't want to use the other path. I think the other path needs to be conserved for a bone crusher giant. Oh, goodness. I need to eat. That's completely my fault. I've been so distracted by actually doing recordings today. Path of bone crusher. Let me play another bone crusher. Nah, we're not coming back from this. Let's go on to round 5. So it's a one lander into a Thalia. I'm going to risk this for the proverbial biscuits. Probably better from the play. Blackcleave Cliffs. Jeez. Inquisition of Kozilek. Okay. Okay. Well, yeah, that's not good. As an understatement, that was actually pretty horrendous. And now that's happened, I realize the error of my ways, and I should have never have kept this. I'm going to play a Temple Garden and pass the turn. Whilst a Renin 6 won't be the death sentence that it once was in that other game, it still wouldn't be great if they went Green Source and Renin 6 here. Oh wow, this is something new, something fresh. This thing makes 5/5s. When it enters the battlefield, if it enters the battle from the graveyard or you cast it from the graveyard, exile it. So Containment Priest is going to be pretty good here. If and when. If and when. Oh. No. Well, I guess I will path that in their draw step. Ah, the old one lander and lose. God. One day I'll learn. After like decades of playing Magic and several years of playing as a content creator now, maybe I'll stop keeping one landers one day. One day. Now, the path in the Archfiend Vessel isn't the greatest thing in the world because obviously we have a Containment Priest to muck around with it, but I think where we're not doing a whole lot, it might be the best course of action. I'm going to slam a Thalia here. Am I slamming a Thalia? Or am I slamming a Arbiter? Well, they're death 6, so there was some equity in the Arbiter making their fetch land worse. Never mind. They correct their fetch now in my end step. They grab a Sacred Family, so they're Mardu colours. They're red, white, and black. Not Mardu like the actual clan of Mardu. There may be not a single card in their deck that actually references the clan of Mardu. But they are those colour combination, just to be really pedantic. Dreadball for 3 mana. Sure. Mr. Landrop again. If you draw a Ghost Quarter, I'm going to... Oh, I thought it was a Ghost Quarter for a second. I was like, whoop, 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 but no, it wasn't. Okay. Let's play Thalia again, because they missed the land drop. They obviously wanted to kill her. Maybe they'll have another 2 mana spell they got to waste on. Oh, I didn't play my land. Oh my goodness, chat, comment section, and everyone in between. Oh, that hurt. That was dumb. That was so dumb. It was unreal. Seasoned Pyromancer, discarding Lingering Souls and Season. So the Mardu tokens with Archfiend of Vessel in the deck as well. God. Okay, we weren't punished. Kinda, maybe, kinda. I guess I'm gonna play an Eldrazi Displacer, which allows me to deal with some of these tokens. And also, if we draw another land, we can flash in Containment Priest and like displace the Seasoned Pyro, for example, to get rid of it forever. Okay. Mardu tokens. With all the mid-range goodness of Dreadborn Inquisition, with the addition of Archfiend's Vessel, how are they replaying from the graveyard, do we think? Maybe they're like one of those mass reanimation spells for like CMCX or less. The Resurrection of the Ranks? Is that one of them? I don't know. Fetchland. Blood's Crypt. Maybe I should have just played Slammed Arbiter next last turn. Three mana for Lingering Souls if they're doing it. This is a bolt. This is a bolt on Thalia. Okay. Bloodstained Mire cracked. This might give them a bolt for the Eldrazi Displacer or a push for the Eldrazi Displacer plus Lingering Souls, which would be pretty bad, honestly. Three mana Liliana of the Veil. Okay. That is pretty bad. Honestly, that's pretty bad. Okay, we'll lose Displacer. We want to draw like another land so we can play 2/2 drops. That'd be nice. Take 4 hit, going to 14. They have 2 cards in hand. They have an active Liliana of the Veil. Land, cool. Okay, let's go Arbiter. Containment Priest. And then we'll discard Containment Priest. And then we'll Eternal Witness back the Displacer, I guess. But then if we do that... Well, we'll draw a card to fill out our hand, because Liliana of the Veil will threaten it. We can't even challenge the Liliana with our current setup. Can't threaten her. I think our deck is generally soft to Planeswalkers. Like, last time I played Green-White on my channel, I played multiple Revokers. And in the Black-White version, I think, if I recall correctly, because it's because of Ren and Six and Urza and Astrolabes and... Guess Liliana of the Veil. We've seen a lot of Liliana this league. So maybe Revoker would be better than Knight of Autumn. Knight of Autumn's a lot... It's quite versatile, but so is Revoker, to be fair. This league, Knight of Autumn, has been pretty terrible. Okay. Combat. No attacks. No tick ups, no tick downs. So you have 3 cards that they very much like. Okay. I can save something with my rest of them, not with the Containment Priest in play, I can't. So let's go. Restoration Angel. Oh, sorry, Eternal Witness, not Restoration Angel. Now they exile all cards from target players' graveyard. Ah, okay, well. Well. Okay. rough. Let's sacrifice the priest. Do I try and take them off white? They'll pay, right? They'll pay. Also, if we do that, we can't Vesto. Like, here we can discard Containment Priest of Liliana and then bring her back with Vesto for the Eternal Witness. So that's definitely something. Vesto also threatens Liliana, so I should have done that a bit earlier. Perhaps. Another spirits are a problem. Was that greedy? Maybe. I can take 2 here. Okay. They again did not take up the Liliana. Maybe I should throw an Arbiter under the bus to get some value out of the Eternal Witness. It's hard to say. No attacks. Let's keep up Resto plus Resto. I wish we had 8 mana though. That would be pretty sweet. They're going to Fatal Push my Arbiter. I'm going to save it. Surprise saving of the Liliana. Way! So Liliana's now the Arbiter. I'm threatening Liliana. They have 2 spirits though. You can tell when I've been looking at a card on the board as I say it out loud. Another card and get the names mixed up, right? That and I'm delirious. I've had so much caffeine today and also it's just so unbelievably warm. Like I am moist in places I did not know moist residue could collect. Three cards in hand, and a Liliana of the Veil they can take up here as well. God, I just don't know what their deck is. Like, Marlu tokens was a thing for a long time, sure, but like post-modern Horizons with the additions of seasoned pyromancers and, well, in this case, Kaya's Guiles and stuff. Okay. Coggins Command. I really hope I don't take up Liliana here. There's gonna be a second K Command, killing the Eternal Witness, making us discard. We can't beat one K Command, let alone two. Jeez. Oh no, what is this? Triple black? Lurus? I see. Well, I guess we just get wrecked. Like, not even remotely close at this point. Lurus can't bring back the Archfiend of Depravity or whatever. Archfiend's Vessel or whatever. Can we play a Seasoned Pyromancer though? We drew a Path to Exile, that's quite good. Let's go to combat. Set Liliana the Veil. A Trumpet with a Spirit. Sure. We'll go to kill the Lurus now. Oh no, I'll do it in the draw step. Because yeah, we can't have them casting permanents then their turn. But Lurus being used fairly, I'm into it. Their deck is sweet. Might have to play it. Well, the idea of playing out Lurus, it does make me want to punch myself in my own genitals and vomit. But, you know, that's probably a bias that I can one day forgive. I let them draw a card. They're playing this new sack instant speed draw cards thing. Jesus, that is not what I expected to see. Where did this all go wrong? I guess it's when we got blew out by Kaya's Guile and Culligan's Command. Powerful multimodal trip double coloured spells, just making me feel like an absolute noob. In comes the Seasoned Pyro and some elementals. We can take it. It's only 3 damage. Barely even a scratch. Each player discards a card. Yep. Taking up the old Liliana of the Veil. Want to draw Blade Splicer or Flicker Wisp. Or even an Eldrazi Displacer at this stage, I guess. Nope. Okay, let's get into the red zone. Take this, Liliana, you turd. I say that. The Spirit will chop block. They have one card in hand, draw to the draw again, 2 cards in hand. Taking up Lily, we'll put it to 4, so we can't even kill her with Resto next turn. Meanwhile, we're getting chunked hard. I say hard. I called it merely a scratch a second ago. What is this? That's a lot of damage. Okay, well, Blade Splicer can still save us. Blade Splicer into Displacer. Take a bunch. 2, 4, 6 damage. Go to 3. Okay. And they down to Liliana of Veil to make us lose our Eternal Witness, I guess. At which point we die even if we draw Blade Splicer? Yeah. The down to the Liliana seals the game. Archfiend Vessel. Yeah, this modern midrange deck seems sick. I'm into it. Druid Knight of Autumn gains his full life as to 7. And then we kill the Liliana of the Veil, block the Pyro, take 4-5, go to 2. Yeah, I guess. The knight just makes us play another turn, even though I don't think we're going to come back from this. The other card in hand might just be another Liliana, which would be pretty funny. They can also cast Lurus and replay Liliana as well. Talk about grindy, eh? K Killing the Pyromancer actually gives him two more bodies, so it doesn't even like lessen the clock next turn. So again, Blade Splicer does what now? It just blocks two and we're still dead. Knight will put us to six. So Knight of Autumn's are only out. Unearth the Lurrus, play the Liliana, sure. No, you don't want to play the Liliana. I want to see what you cast. I'm not skipping till you cast something. Come on. They decided not to cast. Yeah, whatever. I don't know why. Why not? Why would you not just slam Liliana there and down tick? Maybe not to give away the tech. Rest in peace. Containment Priests obviously seem very, very good here. Really, really good. Scavengers and Rips seem good. Selfless Spirit against the removal. And I guess if we're grinding, Gideons get better. I think my Thalias might just be terrible. Like, genuinely terrible. Although they might be better than my Vials versus the Colligan's Command deck. Actually, the Colligan's Command deck, so the Thalia making that cost four is a thing. Okay, let's give that a shot. The problem with Aether Vial as well that we haven't really discussed this video is that if you have multiple Aether Vials in the decks where you're going to top deck wars, like Liliana of the Veil decks, things like traditional Jund, or in this case this hot pile of hot value that we're playing against, drawing multiple Vials across the course of a game, which obviously gets more and more likely the longer the game goes, is bad. It's just a bad top deck. So not only is it vulnerable to, like I said earlier, like the traditionally old school Abrupt Decays, and then Cake Command when it came around, and nowadays Assassin's Trophy, so it can just get blown out, and then your reliance upon it ruins you. But it also means that your top decks get a lot worse in the late game, because even if your Vial gets blown up, drawing an Aether Vial on like turn 6 or 7 can be like backbreaking to the point that you just lose. Right, I would love to play first. I'm going to keep this hand. So, Containment Priest doesn't turn off Lurrus, FYI. It stops things that weren't cast. So, it stops the Resurrection through Unearth, for example, but it doesn't stop Lurrus from casting the spell. So, we need to deal with Lurrus another way. In this case, the Path to Exile that's in our hand right now. They've mulled to five, so that's a blessing for us. I guess I'm going to leave with Scavenging Ooze. Or do I leave with Containment Priest because they've got two and they're not good in multiples? That's probably better. Obviously, if I draw an Arbiter or a Thalia here, that might be a consideration as well. Selfless Spirit's pretty good for protecting our next follow-up spell, so let's play a Spirit. Skooks is better with a follow-up mana, the Containment Priest is better like flashed in the end step. Don't forget the Containment Priest is a non-bow, a non-synergy, a non-sin, a sin-non. I don't know what the term would be, for Restoration Angel, or with Restoration Angel. They didn't have a removal spell to immediately kill my Selfless Spirit, so that's a positive. Imagine if Leland Arbiter had Flash. I mean, I know that's what Vial does, but imagine if he had Flash, like, on his own. God, that's like, maybe that's my invitational card. A legendary Arbiter from the Plane of Mirrodin. Just a 2-2 for 2. It has Flash. And the text of Leland Arbiter. And maybe Lifelink. Is that so much to ask? Shock themselves, double black, ransack the lab, put top three cards in the library, look at them, put one into the hand, the rest into the graveyard. So we want to draw a green soul system. We can slam scavengers just eat, I don't know, a lingering souls or a body they put in the yard. There's a lingering souls there. So drawing a green soul here would be so good. Come on. No, that's the opposite of that. All right, let's attack on the Selfless Spirit. I guess I'll keep up Path for Allurus or I'll Flash and Containment Priest. Good chances they're just cast Lingering Souls. They've also probably got another land drop because Ransack the Lab would have dug them into a land, I'd assume. There's the Bloodstained Mire. If they tap out for a Lily here and down, take, we can Flash and Containment Priest, sack the Containment Priest, untap and scooze them if we draw a land. I feel like they got K Command in hand. That's what I feel is happening here. Do they K Command my Containment Priest and get me to discard here? That's probably what their plan is, right? Oh, I'll let the K Command kill the Containment Priest and carry on attacking with the Selfless Spirit. Not 11 from all the shocking and fetching and the attack from the Selfless Spirit, so that's good. So K Command, target Containment Priest, plus me discard. Oh, they're shooting the Selfless Spirit. That is a shame. Okay. What would I like to discard here? Probably Restoration Angel. Doesn't play well with the Containment Priests. It's a body for the Scavenging Ooze to eat. Drew another non-land. Okay. Let's attack. If we play Scooze, it will force them to cast Lingering Souls. Like, to get the value out before we untap. Also, we can like swing our Containment Priest into the tokens, have them block them because they think they're getting some like getting a problematic hate piece off the board. Then we just flash the other Containment Priest in response to like an unearth or similar. Double red and white, Seasoned Pyro. Okay. Discarding a Seasoned Pyromancer and an Archfiend's Vessel. A land would be lovely, come on. Oh, that is so rough. It's unreal. So I can eat something with my Scooze. I can Path the Pyromancer. That involves sacking my own lands off. Is that a bit ham? Yes, probably. Considering I have 2-4 drops in hand, I don't know if Ghost Quarter of myself is a way towards winning this game. Attack with a priest. Do they double block with the elementals? Okay, you gotta clear that board out somehow, right? So, priest dies, elementals die. They're on 9. Okay. Now, if we don't eat the Lingering Souls, they're going to use it. If we don't eat the Seasoned Pyromancer, they're going to use it. None of these things seem great. None of these things seem great. Can I eat the Pyromancer here? If they go Luris, and then they go to cast the Archfiend's Vessel, I'm going to eat the Archfiend's Vessel by Ghost Quartering myself. Oh, come on. Come on. Okay, we lose the Scooze. we need to draw a land. Like, just any land. Literally any land. Like, even. I say, actually, that's not even true. If I draw a non-white source, I can't cast a Wisp. Just run a lands, though, at this point, to get into, like, Shalai Gideon territory. We did not draw a land. Magic is a harsh mistress. And. Yeah, not great. Okay. Let's just pass the turn. We have Path to Exile up. We have Containment Priest up. We're going to be asked to discard a card. I'm probably going to discard Chulai. I think Gideon is too valuable and choose to discard in this matchup. If they play Alluris, we can path it. Playing Containment Priest doesn't do anything. They get to cast the Archfiend's Vessel. And then they get a 5/5. And then we sob, weep openly. Our opponent has mulliganed to 5 and has drawn the cards and lands they need. We've drawn only the cards we need, not the lands. I can understand why Yu-Gi-Oh players often rag on Magic players for the problems with the with our mana system, because this feels pretty rough. Fetch land from our opponent. Tick up. I'm going to discard Chulai. Actually, Shalai is more likely to be cast. I'm going to discard Gideon. Shalai is not double white, so we can draw like Ghost Quarter plus Eldrazi Temple or Gavin and still cast it. End of turn, let's make a Containment Priest. Maybe they won't understand how Containment Priest works and not go for Alluris Archfiend because they think it'll stop it. We drew another 2-drop. We're going to pass back to our opponent. At least we drew a castable spell. It doesn't help anything because we already had that castable spell in our hand already. So, yeah. Three mana. Each opponent sacrifices a creature and you gain 4 life. Okay. Doesn't feel great. Feels pretty rough, if I'm completely real about it. So they untap with like all the mana they need. They draw a second card. We've got 4 cards in hand, so we are beating them on cards in hand. And most Magic players will tell you that's where it really counts, right? Like if you have more cards in hand than your opponent, you'll definitely win. There's that old conversation between Flood and Screw, right? Like Flood, you can play your top decks, but Screw means that when you eventually hit the land colors or numbers you need, you can cast the cards in your hand, but I think it's probably too late here. They drew Assistant Pyromancer. Playing a lot of cards that like give them this card selection digging element here. Wait, they had no cards in hand, they just drew two. It was like raw card advantage. We can't block the 2/2 here because then it just means that Liliana kills whatever we play next. If Flicker Wisp would kill one of the 1/1s, that's something. Then I make 2 more 1/1s that don't fly next turn. Oh, there we go. We drew a land. It may be like around 15 turns too late. And by 15, I mean maybe 5. Pass back to our opponent, who now have 3 cards in hand. So they've now gone to more lands in play, more borders on board, more planeswalkers, and more cards in hand. Yeah, Season Pyromancers end up being real good. And we get our Arbiter pushed, and we get our Flickerus killed. Okay, I've seen enough. I am happy to concede here. So, we went 2-3, which is a miserable result. That makes me feel very, very sad. I don't like feeling sad. That might be one of the problems we have with playing some of the Eternal formats these days. I don't seem to win anything ever anymore. Green-white's not felt very good recently. Black-white felt better. I think we went positive with black-white in the last league that I played with that, but we lost. We went negative win rate with the green-white when we dropped when we played in modern but prior to Containment Priest. What do we learn here? What do we learn? So, I think that playing Containment Priest in main just isn't going to be good enough. The mid-range decks. So, it's Containment Priest is good against some unfair decks, that being maybe Dredge. Neobrand, and I guess Goryeo's Vengeance, Bob Rigmos, what's it called? Whatever the hell that's called. That no one plays anymore, right? Everyone plays Neo Reform instead. It's good into those, and I guess it plus Displacer is good in a long, long grind. The problem being the long, long grind decks in Eternal formats, like Modern specifically, and to an extent Legacy nowadays as well, are the ones with just really high card quality, to the point that trying to get your synergetic engine of like Displacer plus Containment Priest online is probably A, too slow, and B, not good enough. Not good enough to fight against the torrent of, we didn't see it today, but like Teferi Uros or Ren and Six Lilianas, or in that case, Season Pyromancer Liliana. It's nice to see Liliana of the Veil seeing some more play again. Imagine if this week we decided to play a deck with like four Loxodon and Smiters and a couple of Legions in it, like a traditional old school actual Green White Hit Bears deck. We probably would have stomped really hard to get all those Lilianas. But yeah, so I don't think this Containment Priest plan main board is working. I don't think it's that good from these five games I've played. I will probably play another league with Containment Priest in the main board before I cast my final vote and move on. I know that's not enough. That's a very small sample size, but I don't have a lab of people testing in Modern for me. Not that I'd ever want to put that many people through that tournament either. Hope you've enjoyed the video. Hope you found it at least informative. There were some good games. There were some bad games. We got frustratingly unlucky with the Mogo into 5 and the just getting stuck on two lands for so long. But also I lost some games to keeping suspect opening hands as well. I think I played relatively tight in the games where my opening hands weren't bad. I think one of the weakest points of me as a player is my opening hands. Mulligan decisions are really hard. One of the most complex things about Magic. So I think that's where I might have gone wrong. If you enjoyed the video, hit the like button. Don't forget to subscribe to me, I'm Pleasant Kenobi, over on youtube.com/PleasantKenobi.